Morning.
Morning.
How are you today?
Great.
Well, some of you are great, all right? The rest of you, the jury's still out, but that's all right. Great. Welcome to have you here. If you are a guest today, it's your first time at New Hope, thank you so very much for being here. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We promise we're not going to irritate you on the phone or annoy you at your door, but through the mail, send you information about New Hope that tells you of services and ministries and opportunities, what we believe, and hopefully answer most of your questions. But so good to have you with us today. Lots of things I got to talk about. Well, not lots of things, but some very, very important things. First off is backing the badges. This is an event coming up 2 weeks from yesterday that we're doing in the parking lot and the pavilion here of our church. October is Make a Difference Month at Church, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment, but we're not going to waste a day. We're going to start on October 1st, that Saturday, and make a difference in the community. Many of you are familiar with the two individuals who were shot at the Fresno County Jail, and we're doing their families. There was one done this past week by the Sheriff's Association in downtown Fresno. They raised $37,000, all right, in doing a barbecue that day. We thought we were being really ambitious, all right, when we talked about $10,000, all right. That's 1,000 ribeye sandwiches. Barbecue and sell on that day, 1,000, all right. Now, there's 550 of you who came to church will be coming to church today. That's half of them right there. So you guys come by that day for a barbecued ribeye steak sandwich, all right? And they're going to be absolutely terrific. And we have a lot of stuff donated and contributions so that everything we make that day all goes to these families. Let me clarify a few things because I've had some people say, Tim, they're sheriffs. I mean, they got a great insurance plan. I'm sure they get paid while they're off. First off, those two individuals are not sheriffs. They work for the Fresno County Sheriff's Department, but they are not sheriffs. They do not make half the pay that sheriffs do. They do not have the same benefits that they do. They do not get the same, they're off work, okay? They don't get paid. And so the sheriff's departments, why they did their big barbecue, because they're coming to help them. We want to be good citizens. We want to come and help them a little bit. And so that's the reason we want to make a difference on October 1st. And so there are some ways in which you can help. What the sign-up sheet is that's going to come around is for that day. There are three ways you can help. Number one, you can put your name on here where it says name and number. Put your name and phone number. And where it says need, you can say, I'll volunteer to help that day. Just say, I'm here to come volunteer. We got guys who are going to barbecue, but we need people who can assemble sandwiches, bag them. We're going to have a drive-through and a park and eat, okay? So people who just want to drive through, grab a sandwich, and go, they can do that. That will be set up in one part, and then another part will be in the shade, some shady areas in front of the sanctuary and in the pavilion. And the biggest difference between drive-through and park and eat, in the drive-through, okay, is going to be cookies, all right? People are volunteering to bring desserts, and so the homemade desserts will be at the park and eat, all right? And so that'll be it. So if you want to bring some desserts, bring them here. We'll take those as well. The other two ways that you can volunteer on here is we're going to need a lot of drinks that day, all right? Water and sodas. So if you can bring a case of water or you can bring a 12 or 20 pack of soda, if you would indicate that on here, you can tell us what you want to bring or just say, hey, one case, two case, that would be terrific. Here's the deal. Bring them from Wednesday to Friday, September the 28th, 29th, or 30th. Okay? Please do not, I know it'd be very convenient to bring them next Sunday. We can't store enough around here, all right, for that. All right, so bring them if you can between Wednesday and Friday that week, okay? And that would be terrific. So that's the only thing on the sign-up sheet is if you can help us with that. So that's back the badges. Let's talk about Make a Difference since we're going to start on October 1st. You have an invitation in your bulletin. It's red on one side, green on the other. The green side says, go man, all right? Go mad. Go make a difference in the world. Five Sundays in October, every Sunday is going to be about make a difference. The first one is make a difference with your life. This is a Sunday we want you to invite a friend who does not know Christ with you. This is not about having a record attendance at New Hope Church. It has nothing to do with that, all right? This has to do with the fact that you know Christ. You have friends and relatives and family that doesn't know Christ. And everything we're going to do that day is geared around to communicating the message of Jesus to those who may not know Him. And so the music that day and the message that day is all about how Christ can make a difference in us for life. And so that's the way we'll kick the month of October off. That's just 2 weeks from today. So you be thinking and be working on that for the next 2 weeks and bring them with you. That Sunday, this service starts at 9 a.m. Only the first Sunday of the month. We're having two services. We're not having an 8 o'clock that day. There will be overflow in our youth center for those two services, but 9 a.m. and 10:45, okay? So please note that change, and this is an invitation. There are more invitations in the foyer, on the tables, and out on the welcome cart in the pavilion if you want to pick up a few more invitations. All right? Yeah, there's the one in the bulletin, and there's more out on the table. All right? Widow's Lunch Bunch, you're meeting after the 10:45 service today at 12:15. The location is in the bulletin. Never been and would like to join them, please take note of where and at what time. Tonight, how many of you here love ice cream? Raise your hand. You like ice cream. All right? Good, good. Some of you aren't raising your hands because you want to wait to see what I'm going to say. All right, that's okay. That's wisdom. Tonight, free ice cream, all right, donated by Häagen-Dazs, all right? So it's good ice cream, all right? Good ice cream tonight. And this is at 6 o'clock. It'll probably go from 6 to 7. This is our Hope group night. Hope means helping other people engage. This is the way we get to know other people better in church. We're going to have an 8-week church-wide Bible study in our small groups kicking off the following week, and you're going to get all the information about that tonight. If you've not been in a Hope group before, or if you want to change Hope groups, it is okay to do that. And you can come tonight and either get them one or change tonight, and Corey and Teddy will help you with that. All right? There are some folks who are willing to start brand new groups as well, and so we are excited to give that a launch tonight. So show up 6 o'clock tonight, ice cream, find out about how you can connect with others in our church. There will be a parent meeting next Sunday at 12:15 for parents of 5th and 6th graders. All right? We've been calling that group for years around here SURF. They're in the process of getting creative and coming up with a new name for that group. But right now we're calling them the 56ers. All right? That's just so, yeah. Isn't that really cool? That's mine. Yeah. 5th and 6th grade. 5th, 6th, 56ers. All right. Yeah. If you have to explain it, it's probably not good. All right? Anyway, there it is. If you made a pledge a couple of months ago in August on our 1040i trip to Ivory Coast of Africa in February, and our project, just a reminder, those pledges are due by the end of October. Last Sunday, I shared with you that I pledged New Hope Church a contribution to Heinz Hospice of $2,500. The more you give, the less I have to give. So if you would like to add some more to what we received last week, just make the check or the cash to New Hope, put it in an envelope, and write on the envelope Heinz Hospice, and that's going to be sent to them at the end of the month. I've just mentioned this a little bit, and I had hoped to have a video to make this a little more meaningful for you for today, but they were not able to get it to us. Hopefully in a couple of weeks we'll have it. As you know, next year, April 1st and 2nd, April Fool's Day and the following day, is going to be what's known as Fresno Clovis City Fest. It's going to be held on the property of St. Bart Center. Most of it's going to be outdoors. You're going to see way like you have never ever seen before. It is going to be high energy. It's going to be major impact. There are going to be dirt bike riders there, professionals doing all their crazy stunts. There are going to be other professional athletes. There are going to be activities for the whole family. And ultimately that leads to a gospel presentation by Luis Palau. Luis Palau is just incredible. He's the South American version of Billy Graham. And out of Oregon these days, and he and his sons have put together an incredible weekend that will be Saturday and Sunday afternoon and evening. And we'll let you know much more about it. But in your bulletin, you will find another insert that looks like this. All right? It says, pray, unite, serve, proclaim. Right now, there's almost 200 churches that are engaged in working together for the Luis Palau Conference. There is a big youth event. Probably going to have 12 to 1,500 young people at it the month of October. There's a big event that we're going to let you know more about in a few weeks in November, on November the 17th, that I hope to have at least 100 from from New Hope attend, and we'll tell you more about that. So things are going to start to build over the next few months. Here's how we would like you to begin to engage today. If you'll notice this card on the back, there's a place for you to put five names. You don't have to fill it in completely, but what names come to mind right away that are your friends, your neighbors, the people that you work with, that you would love for them to know Jesus Christ? Put their name on here and begin to think between now and next April, how can I get them to go to an event with me? All right? And begin praying for them right now. This card, if you do this, it's perforated. If you already have those names popping in your head right now, you can fill it out before our offering. Tear this off. Put it in the offering bag. Here's why. And if you've got a short memory, take a tithing envelope and write the names on it for you to keep. But we want you to tear this off, dump in the offering bag for two reasons. Number one, we're going to begin praying as a church staff for these names between now and next April. Number two, the Luis Palau Crusade, all right, the Fresno City Fest office, they're going to come pick these up every week as we get them. A team specifically that meets every single week, and they will in prayer every single week mention every single name that they have received from us. So we want you to be engaged by praying, uniting, serving, and proclaiming. And so more to come about this, but you can get started today by putting your name and information on here. They'll send you updates about what's happening. You won't have to wait to hear it just for me, and they'll begin to pray for your family members and friends. Let's talk about a few praise items and prayer requests. Some of us had the privilege last evening of being right here in the New Hope Sanctuary for a most unique wedding ceremony. It was a 50th anniversary of marriage between Jerry and Cheryl Molinari from our church family. And they wanted to renew their vows. They wanted to do that for a couple of reasons. Number one, their lives are very different today than they were when they got married. They were religious when they got married. Now they know Jesus. That happened 18 years ago right here. And so they wanted that statement to be made to their family and friends. They actually had three people in the service who were at and or in their wedding 50 years ago. Came up from Arizona and Southern California, and that was pretty cool. Jerry had just been out of the Marines a short time when he met Cheryl. And he had some ghosts that he had to deal with. That's how Jerry became Mr. Grizzly Bear Authority. He went and lived about 6 months in Alaska, saw one human being during that time, and it was an Indian. He saw every day dozens of grizzlies because he lived in a very remote area. As he chased the ghost and the demon out of his life and acclimated back to normal society living. Jerry bought something he had never purchased in his life, even as a Marine. Jerry had never owned a set of dress blues from the Marine Corps. And he ordered one for this wedding ceremony last night. And when he walked out of that opening right there onto center stage in full dress Marine blues and his saber, did not everybody go, oh. Somebody said they're surprised it still fit. Well, they didn't know it was new. Number two, it wouldn't have fit, okay? Because he is half the size he was when he got out of the Marines. The gym today, in those days, was over 300 pounds. He was a big, big man. And so anyway, it was just an absolutely wonderful, wonderful evening. And of course, Cheryl looked like a Barbie doll, all right, of married 50 years, all right, to Ken. And it was just absolutely a great, great night. So they're probably not going to be here. They partied probably much longer than the rest of us did. But please let them know when you see them next time. Congratulations. Please remember to pray for the Robertson and Smart families, Dale Robertson and Karen Smart. Both of those were memorial services on Friday, and they can use God's care and comfort. Jerry Brown. Our Jerry Brown, not Governor Jerry Brown, he went in for a test on Tuesday, was asked to come back on Thursday for an angiogram. His kidneys were not functioning well enough to do the angiogram on Thursday. They kept him overnight and assisted him with his kidneys. They got better. They did the angiogram and put his 12th stent in his heart. On Friday, he went home yesterday, and the rumor pastor around here is, he may be here at the 10:45 service, all right? We heard that from three folks today already. Jerry said if he's up to it, he's coming here because he's grateful for another lease on life for a while. So continue to pray for Jerry. Bobby Clark, besides his other health issues, he is getting stronger, but he's going to be having cataract surgery on Tuesday. Would appreciate you praying for him. Continue to remember our cancer patients who are going through treatment right now, Polly Good and Charlene Dooms. And then we just heard about this in last service. Larry Baumeister is having knee surgery tomorrow. His wife is a regular attendee in our 8 o'clock service. So those are our updates that we needed to bring to you. It's great to have you here. I am, some of you asked, Tim, you are a little more than normal for summer. There is a very good reason for that. The service, as soon as it ends, I zip right down that hallway and out the doors, and I'm jumping in the car, and I'm heading for Montana. So a little getaway. And I can't wait, but I'd rather preach to you before I go. So I do suspect that the 10:45 service will probably get out at 12 o'clock, right on time. I'm just suspecting that might happen today, but it might not. Who knows? But anyway, so glad you're here, and I'm glad I'm here, and then I'm glad I can't wait to go. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. You should have seen Mike Chin and Mike Rude yet last night, all right, dressed in a navy blue tux, red vest, and red bow ties. They look just like the waiters at the finest restaurant I've ever eaten in, but no, they look good. They look good. They dressed up for the event. Let's pray. Father, it's great to enjoy life, and it's great to share life with you. In fact, I'm convinced that we enjoy life better when we share life with you. And so thank you for the privilege of doing that this week in so many different ways, from successful surgeries to memorial services where your presence was evident, to wedding and anniversary celebrations, to this morning, Father, where your word will be shared. Father, we commit to you the needs that we've already talked about, those with surgery scheduled, those still going through treatment, those who have other challenges that they're still in the waiting room for. We commit each of them to you. For those concerns that are very personal and private to those who've gathered here today, we know that you know infinitely and intimately about them. And we pray for our availability to be used by you to be of encouragement, hope, and comfort to them. Father, the proclamation of your word today is not about how good the preacher is. It's about how much each of us are willing to listen to your spirit as you speak to us out of your word. The scripture says it this way, that it's by the foolishness of preaching. The Bible says that the act of preaching is kind of a peculiar thing to do. But it's out of this peculiarity that lives are changed. Differences are made by the foolishness of preaching, the word says. Men and women are saved, born again. Their destinies are changed, and their destination is forever transferred from hell to heaven. And so, Father, as your word is shared today, may the power of the word take its effect in our lives as we let the truth take root and do a difference in our lives. Father, thank you for this day, all you want to do, for the privilege of giving and sharing. We say thanks. In Christ's name. Amen. I invite you to take your Bibles, if you would, to the very same psalm that we were in last week. All right? That's 126. All right? Just in case. Yeah, 126, in case you didn't remember. And while you're turning there, if you want to go to the Gospels and find Mark chapter 4, we're going to be in both of those places in just a few minutes. We were in Psalm 126 last week. It is a great psalm. And we didn't finish it, so we're going to look at it from a little different perspective than we did last week. Last week, we looked at it exactly. It was, tried to get a picture of what it was like when this hymn was written. We shared with you that the first two verses are a narrative. It's telling the story. The next verse is the song that comes as a result of the incredible story. And then after we sing, we pray. All right, it's kind of like church. And so the next verse is a song, and then the last two verses is a promise, a challenge and a promise. So let's jump in and read it. When the Lord brought back the captives to Zion, remember Israel had been enslaved for 70 years, and they didn't have to be there that long. They could have been set free earlier. They didn't want to be, because they looked at the challenge of going back home and rebuilding their hometown, and they weren't very motivated to do that. So slavery seemed better than rebuilding. And it wasn't until God sent them a prophet, all right, to kind of build a fire under them that they got excited about going home. And so now they're going home, and it says, we were like men who dreamed. This was a dream come true. Freedom. Home. Then it was said among the nations. The sad thing for me about this is it wasn't said by Israel first. It was said by the people who were looking at what God was doing for Israel. And they said, the Lord has done great things for them. Don't think the world's not watching you if you profess to be a Christian. If you say you know God, the world is looking at you and me because they want to see if the God you believe in does great things in your life. And then notice what the nations noticing did for Israel. Then verse 3, the Lord does great things for us and we are filled with joy. And that's a hymn. That's a song that has been written both in old hymns and new worship songs. He has done great things. Then the prayer, restore our fortunes, O Lord, like streams in the Negev. That's the desert. How many of you have ever read a devotional book called Streams in the Desert by Miss Cowan? All right, it's a great, great devotional book. Janet, I would expect you to have read that one, all right? It was the number 2 on the best-selling list of devotionals when we were at the Bible House. My Utmost for His Highest, number 1, Streams in the Desert, number 2. Those who sow in tears will reap with songs of joy. He who goes out reaping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves. Had to define for a few folks what sheaves were last week, all right? Do you remember? What was a sheave? Yeah, like corn stalks all tied together in a bundle so you could carry them back to the threshing floor. You could carry your harvest back, and you did that with great joy. The more bundles you had to carry, the more joy there was. And so you and I, we are to spread seed so we can come back later and carry the sheaves with us. Got a quick story. I think I have time. After the service last Sunday, where I talked about the sheaves and I explained it, and I told you that the day before in a memorial service in Bakersfield, had a 19-year-old young lady walk right up at the end of the service and give her life to Christ. And so I was celebrating. I was rejoicing, carrying my sheaves to church the next day. Because it's not often that you get a 19-year-old. I mean, literally during the final prayer at the memorial service, this young lady had walked down a row right up in front of where I was speaking from. And when I said amen, she was standing right there. And she said, I want to find God. Right there. Boom. And after about 10 minutes of conversation, I tried to talk her out of it. Couldn't persuade her. And so we prayed. And she invited Christ in her life. It was so cool. And so after the last service last Sunday, there was a lady who's been here 2 weeks in a row. And she came up and she sat right where Shasky's sitting right now, and she just waited till everybody left. Okay, greeted me in the last service. And she said, do you have just a couple of minutes, Tim? I said, sure. Good thing it's not today. That didn't sound unkind, did it? And she said, and so she said, I want you to know. She said, 6 weeks ago at a service you did here, and she mentioned the person's name. She said, I gave my life to Christ. During the service, I gave my life to Christ. She said, I came to church last Sunday. I'm one of your sheaves. I said, oh, thank you. And then she said, I called my sister last week to tell her about this change in my life. So my sister lives in Vegas, and I called to tell her, and my sister was so excited for me. And she said, well, who was the preacher? And so she said, well, it's Tim Rowland. And she said, my sister started laughing. And I thought, oh my goodness, what am I going to hear now? She said, my sister told me not to tell you what her maiden name was, but just to tell you a story and see if you remember. I said, oh my goodness. She said, Hoover High School. I really then thought, oh my goodness. She said she was on the diving swimming team. And she said, you guys have become buddies in a class, but one day you said to my sister, I don't think you'd be very good for me. I remembered saying that. I knew exactly who it was. She was a terrific young lady, but it was probably more than what I could have handled in those days appropriately, all right? And I said, oh, my goodness. And I then remembered the name, all right, which I had not thought of in a long, long time. But isn't it funny how God works? All right, I mean, 40 years separate, you know, knowing, and then here's a person who at a funeral, all right, again, gives their life to Christ. It's really what this message today is all about, and it's not just for us preachers to spread the seed. And so what we're going to look at today, and that's why I wanted you to turn to Mark chapter 4. I have a sneaking suspicion that the Lord Jesus, as he was preaching on this particular day, it wouldn't have surprised me if Jesus had sung the hymn 126. If he hadn't have sung it, it probably went through his memory banks as he thought about, how can I connect a story to the people I'm speaking to that will help them understand the importance of scattering seed? So let's read Jesus' own parable. And the beautiful thing about the parable is sometimes parables are a bit challenging to figure out, but then he explains it. So let's jump in. Chapter 4, verse 1. On another occasion, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and he set out in the lake. Why do you think he did that? He didn't have a sound system. I suggest to you, he bounced his voice off the water because this was a very large crowd. Makes sense, doesn't it? That's just my thought on it. It doesn't say it here, but it makes good sense. Or he wanted a quick getaway at the end of the service, one or the other. He taught them many things by parables, and in his teaching he said this, listen, a farmer went out to sow a seed. And as he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and they ate it up. And some fell on the rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. And when the sun came out, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. Or other seeds fell among the thorns. I was probably about 17 years old. I believe it was St. Louis, Missouri. And I heard a gentleman by the name of W.S. Mooneyham. He was the president of World Vision. And I heard him preach out of this passage. And he read from a version, it was called the New English Version. And I'll just always remember, other seed fell among the darnel. Where's Mark? Where's our resident? Does that make sense in to you folks in England? The darnel? Because it's an old English version, all right, or no, the New English version, but apparently that was an English word for thistles and thorns. Personally, I like thistles and thorns. But they grew up and they choked out the plant, so they did not produce or bear grain. Still, other seed fell on good soil. It came up, it grew, it produced a crop, multiplying 30, 60, or even 100 times. Lots of sheaves. Pop over to verse 13. Then Jesus said to them, don't you understand this parable? How will the farmer sows this word. Some people are like seed along the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and he takes away the word that was sown in them. Others like seed sown on rocky places hear the word and at once receive it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. And when trouble or persecution comes because of the word, somebody makes fun of them, they quickly fall away. Still others are like seed sown among thorns. They hear the word, but the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, the desires for other things come in and they choke out the word, and it's not fruitful. Others are like seed on good soil. They hear the word, they accept it, and they produce a crop, some 30, 60, or even 100 times what was sown. There's an old story told about Oliver Wendell Holmes. In fact, I've told it a time or two myself. It's the eminent Supreme Court justice. Justice Holmes often traveled to speaking engagements on a train because that was the major mode of rapid travel in his day. One day he was riding the train and he was reading the newspaper when the conductor came by asking for his ticket so he could punch it. Mr. Holmes searched his coat pockets for his ticket. He checked in his pants pocket, looked in his vest, and every time he came up empty, no ticket. Finally, the conductor, who knew Justice Holmes, said, Justice Holmes, don't worry. I am sure the great Pennsylvania Railroad won't mind if you send your tickets to us when you find it. The distinguished jurist looked up the conductor and said, my dear young man, the problem for me today is not where is my ticket. The problem is, where am I going? In today's world, there's a lot of people that really don't know where they're going. They're so busy with life that they fail to consider the consequences of their life outside of Christ. It is our privilege, those of us who are here today, go by the name Christian. And by that, I don't mean a member of this church or baptized in a particular denomination. What I mean by Christian is a man or a woman, a boy or a girl, who has come to a personal conclusion in their life that they can't do life without God. To come to that conclusion, you have to believe two things. You have to believe, first of all, something about yourself, and you have to, second of all, believe something about Jesus Christ. You must, first of all, believe about yourself that you are a sinner. Not a popular term in the 21st century. But there's no way to soft soap this reality. You can't ease yourself into this relationship with God. It comes through confession. Confession is what is required when we understand that we are a sinner. And a sinner is somebody who makes decisions without God. We try to put sins to it, like adultery and lying and cheating. All those are symptoms of the bigger sin. The bigger sin is choosing life without God, thinking that I can make the best decisions for myself, and I make them for myself. Independent living from Him. Once you believe that, then you also have to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And once we confess that we are a sinner and entrust our lives to Jesus Christ, it is at that instant that the Word of God has taken root into my life, and then I get to experience what Jesus said to Nicodemus could be his experience. I could be born again. That's what it means to be a Christian. Nothing less, nothing more, nothing else. Jesus in me. And if you and I are Christians, and we're here this morning, God has given to us the wonderful privilege to point others in the right direction. Just as probably somebody pointed you in the right direction. In fact, let's take a moment. Somebody give me a name. Who pointed you in the right direction? Give me a name. Give me a name. Wanda. Wanda pointed you in the right direction. Aren't you grateful for Wanda? Okay. How long has it been since you've seen Wanda? About 8 years, but you're still great. You'll never forget the name. Somebody else. Who else on this side?
Linda.
Who?
Linda,
all right. I know the Linda you're talking about. All right, yes, indeed. Yeah, pointed you in the right direction. Let's go this side. Just give me a name. Toss out a name. Who pointed you in the right direction? Nobody saved on this side? What was that? Mel. How long has it been since you've seen Mel?
40 years.
40 years, but you haven't forgotten him, huh? Haven't forgotten him. Anybody else? Oh, what? Sunday school teacher pointed you in the right direction. How many found Jesus without anybody pointing you in the direction? Just found him all on your own. That doesn't happen very often. One out of about 160 probably in here this morning. It's a rare occasion. We find God all on our own. When I say all on their own, I mean without human help, because the Holy Spirit was chasing her, just as the Holy Spirit chases every single one of us. God knocks at our door again and again and again. We often just don't recognize His knock. You see, what's so very important, I threw this out at you 3 or 4 weeks ago, and you're going to hear it again and again from now to the end of the year. Direction determines destination. That is a principle that is immutable. Okay? Direction determines. I don't care what plan you have. Plans do not determine destination. Don't misunderstand me. I think it's great to plan. But you can have the best budget in the world, and if you go a different direction, you're going to be in trouble. You ever been there? You ever have a budget? You ignored the plan? It didn't turn out well, did it? You may have the desire to be the most moral person there is. That might be the desire of your heart. But every decision that you make is a decision about direction. And when you fudge on morality, the destination is not going to be the plan you had to be moral. It is going to end up in the immorality. See, direction. That's why Jesus said, I am the what? I am the way. And that's the first. And all three of those things are really, really important. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. Okay? But if you don't follow the way to the truth, you will never discover the life. Okay? So direction is absolutely essential. These two passages, both Psalm and Mark, challenge us to sow the seed of the gospel, the good news of God's truth, into the life of those anywhere around us, and then pray that it will take root, and pray that there will be a harvest that will take place someday. Let's take a few minutes now, and let's consider the various parts of the players in the story. Let's consider, first of all, the passionate sower. Who is the sower in both of these passages? I suggest to you it's every one of us who have experienced new birth in Jesus Christ. Notice what Jesus said in John chapter 20, verse 21. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be unto you, as my Father has sent me, even so send I you." And if you want to go check out the context, you'll discover he's not just talking to his 12 disciples. He's talking to another large crowd, just like right here, all right? Probably bigger than this one. And he says, as my Father sent me, in the same way my Father sent me, I'm sending you. What does that mean? God the Father sent God the Son to earth to live as a created man the way God intended Adam to live when he created him in the garden. God intended Adam back then to live in full dependence upon the God who created him. And God the Father intended Jesus the Son, when he sent him to the earth to be born of a virgin woman, he intended Jesus to do what Adam failed to do. He expected his Son to live every moment of every day in absolute dependence upon the Father who lived within him. And he did. Because Jesus said on another occasion, everything you see me do and everything you hear me say, it is my Father who lives in me who does it. And it is now this Jesus who said, as my Father sent me with all that the Father is for everything that I the Son may need in my life on earth, I am now going to send you out into the world. So what does that mean for you and me? Just as Jesus successfully did what God the Father wanted Jesus to do with his life, because Jesus surrendered his will to the will of his Father, everything he said and everything he did was God at work in him. Now, Jesus says about you and me, I will be in you just as my Father was in me, so that everything I ask of you, I will do it for you if you'll let me. So here's the question, will you let him? Will you let him? Not just for 12 disciples. It's the reason, folks, that it was said about the first century church. They literally, the Christians, turned the world upside down. Because it wasn't done by their genius. It wasn't done by their personalities. It wasn't done by their strong wills. It was done by the surrender of their wills to the all-sufficiency of Jesus Christ who lives within them. Are you letting him be sufficient for everything in your life? Can you imagine a person who called themselves a farmer, yet they would not sow seed? Can you imagine being a Christian and not sharing Christ? General Eisenhower once rebuked one of his generals for referring to a soldier as just a private. He reminded him that the army could function better without generals than it could without privates. He said, if this war is to be won, it will be won by the privates. In the same way, the common, ordinary Christian thinks, I can't do much. You are the very backbone of God's kingdom work in the world. So who's the sower? If you know Jesus, it's you. It's me. Where are we to sow? I think the answer is found in Isaiah 32:20, amongst other places. But Isaiah writes it this way, blessed are you that sow beside all waters. You see, the church is not the only place to sow. In fact, I'm not sure a whole lot of sowing ought to be going on. I mean, we have throw the seed out there, but most of you have already got the seed. What we need to do is we need to tell folks, get out there and sow. When you leave the church, I think it was G.L. Johnson who had a sign put up outside People's Church that said, you are now entering the mission field. Okay, you are now entering the mission field. That's where we sow. We learn about the word here, we sow out there. When are we to sow? Listen to what the wise man Solomon wrote in Ecclesiastes 11, verses 4 and 6. He said, whoever watches the wind, they will not plant. And whoever looks at the clouds, they will not reap. He said, if you're always worried about the climate, it'll never be a good day to sow seed. There'll always be something in the way. If I throw seed out and it's windy, it blows the seed away. Hey, who knows where to land? It might land where it does the best good. And he goes on to say, sow your seed in the morning. Sow your seed in the evening. Sounds like a song we used to sing in church. Do not let your hands be idle, for you do not know which will succeed, whether it's this one or that one, or whether both will do equally well. The harvest is not up to us, but the scattering of the seed, according to Psalms and Mark 4, it is on our back. One pastor tells of a lady who was a member of his church. She had a car accident, and she was knocked unconscious. An ambulance was called to the scene, and on the way to the hospital, she came to. And the first thing she did was she looked in the eyes of the young man who was staring down at her on the bed in the back of the ambulance. And she said, young man, if you died today, do you know that you'd go to heaven? I bet he had never had anybody else wake up in his ambulance and ask that question before. I guess he could not give her a very answer, because the end of the story is that lady led that person to Christ before she got to the hospital. That's uncanny, isn't it? I love it. Seize every opportunity. All right, it was kind of like she was raised from the dead, got his attention. I'm not going as far as to say that God caused her to be knocked out in a car accident so that she could lead that young man to Christ, but I will say this, all things work together for good to those who love God and trust his purpose. So God wasn't going to waste her unconscious state, and he found a good way to put it to use, and they did. We ought to be ready to sow. Anytime, anywhere. And what is it that we as farmers of the word are supposed to sow? Is it we are supposed to do this? John 3:36 gives us the answer. He that believes in the Son has everlasting life. And the one who does not believe in the Son does not have life. And most of us stop right there. Most of us stop right there in that verse. But the verse is not finished. There's a semicolon. The rest of the verse clarifies the destination of the person who does not have Jesus Christ. But the wrath of God abides on them. See, we kind of like to downplay this a little bit and say, okay, if you know Jesus, and if you don't know Jesus, well, that's not nice. No. If you know Jesus, you have life and heaven. If you don't have Jesus, you have death and hell. We don't need to soft coat the truth. That's the reality. We don't need to soft coat the truth for our friends and family who don't know Jesus. More importantly, we don't need to soft coat that for us as farmers. Because if we think, oh, it's not such a big deal, then we're not going to succeed. But if we realize that our children and our grandchildren and our neighbors that we love and our best buds that we like to go hang out with. If they don't have Christ, then they do not have life. And if they don't have life, they have the wrath of God. In an article in 1996 on the crash of Value Jet number 592 out of Miami, Florida, the writer noted that the black box recorder had picked up the screams of people on that plane, and they were yelling, "I'm on fire! I'm on fire!" Do you remember the story that Jesus told of the rich man and Lazarus? In life, the rich man had everything you could want, and Lazarus was poor and sick and broken. And Lazarus had begged the rich man for just some scraps off his table. He didn't even ask to sit at the table. He said, "Could you just give me a few scraps of your table?" And the rich man said, "I don't have time for you." And then they both died. And we get a picture into the next world. And the scripture said, after death, Lazarus was in the bosom of Abraham, heaven, paradise. And the rich man was in Hades, hell. And the scripture says the rich man now cried out, where before Lazarus had cried out to the rich man, this time the rich man cries out to Lazarus. And he says, "Lazarus, hey, could you dip your fingers in some water and drop them on my tongue so that I might have some relief from the torment that I am in?" And Abraham butts in. He says, "No, it can't be done, because there is this great divide between the place of blessing and the place of torment, and there is no crossing once you've entered." Do you understand what that means to a person that you love who doesn't love Christ? That's why we are to sow. Our job is to sow and leave the results to God. We are to be like the farmer in trust. The farmer trusts the Lord for the sun, and he trusts him for the rain, and he works the crop, but the farmer has nothing to do with production. That is God's work. Second of all, let's consider the precious seed. We've looked at the sower. Let's look at the seed. What is the seed? It is the Word of God. Mark 4:15 tells us that. This parable is very straightforward as Jesus defines it. It doesn't require a lengthy explanation. I think a couple of key points need to be made about the seed, which is the Word of God. First of all, this seed is precious because of its inspiration. The Word of God will inspire us for transformation in our own life. I get inspired as I think the transformation by the faith of Abraham. I get excited when I discover how Joseph, as a young man, stayed pure. The courage of Moses, an old man, yet still being used of God. By the love of the heart of David, even though he was a screw-up at times, he still had a passionate heart for God. I love the boldness of John the Baptist. The Bible ought to be there to inspire us. D.L. Moody, the founder of Moody Bible Institute, once was asked how he knew the Bible was inspired. And he said, "I could give you many reasons, but the main reason I believe the Bible is inspired is because it inspires me." The Bible is precious because it's inspiration. It's precious because it's filled with instruction. There is a lot of wisdom and direction which determines destination in this book. But you see, here's the problem. A lot of people have the words of this book in the library of their life, not in the living room of their life. What I mean by that is we have head knowledge of it, but we don't have it in our heart where we make decisions with, and we need to move it from just the library into the living room of our life so that it's functional. A man inherited an antique desk. One day by accident, he touched a secret spring and an unknown drawer popped open. And inside that drawer was a large stack of money. Now, the antique desk had value just on its own, but the treasure it contained was even more valuable. People often treat this book with great reverence because it's called the Bible. But when you open it, that's when you find the wealth. God's word is priceless. It's precious. Unknown riches await those who will be willing to search for them. Remember Psalm 19:10 we looked at several weeks ago? More to be desired than gold. Yes, the word of God is better than fine gold. It is sweeter than honey in the honeycomb. It's also precious because of its impact. Have you ever noticed the power of a seed as it sprouts? It comes through hard, crusty ground sometimes. Have you ever noticed in a parking lot of either asphalt or concrete, and you've seen a plant come through a crack? Often it caused the crack. Have you seen city utilities people have to tear up a sidewalk? Why? Because a tree grew and its roots spread out and it moved the concrete. The Word of God can make an impact on our lives as well. It is powerful. That's the reason it transforms lives. And last of all, let's consider the prospective soil. What does the soil represent? It's pretty obvious by what Jesus had today had to say that it represents the condition of different hearts that hear the gospel. The gospel is the word of God. It's the seeds. It's spread by you and me. That's our part. Now, it's going to fall on soil. That's the hearer's part. What kind of soil do they have to receive the word of God? He talks about four. Hard, shallow, thorny, and good. Let me give you four other words just because I like alliterations, okay? There is the calloused heart. That's the hard one. As the gospel is preached, as it's shared, whether it's in our living room or from a podium, they refuse to receive the word. They listen, but it doesn't penetrate the hardness of their heart. The seed got on it, but it never got in it. It's like a duck shedding water in the rain. The second kind of heart is a changeable heart. There are others who will hear the message. They'll respond emotionally to it. They become excited, enthusiastic. Often they've come through a dark place in their life and ready for something that will challenge them. And the first time, though, they hear the word and take it in, and then times get tough. Another struggle comes along, and they just revert back to their old ways. They drop out. They start hanging out with a crowd doing the same old stuff. It may appear at very first glance that they were saved, but if their response doesn't go beyond just the intellect, the library, if it's just them emotionally being engaged, if it doesn't ever get to the surrender of their will, then when affliction and difficulties come, they wither under the heat. Why? Because there was no roots, all right? No root system, no commitment, a surface profession. Reminds me of two guys I heard about who had been lost at sea for days. And one of them began to pray, "Oh Lord, I've broken most of the commandments. I've got some really bad habits. I drink, I cuss, I steal, I treat people like dirt. But if you'll spare my life right now, I promise I'll change once again. I'll never..." The guy, whoa, stop, buddy. I think I see a ship coming. It's often like a lot of folks. Okay, God, I don't need you after all. Number three, there's the cluttered heart. This soil represents the type of heart that responds to the gospel in a very positive manner. It gives a lot of indication that this is a sincere and valid decision. However, it's not long until the desires of the flesh or the temptations of the world prompt this person to say, "I really want this stuff more than I want God." And they return to the world and they leave God behind. This is the type of person who claims Christ but demonstrates no change in a life. Lord Kenneth Clark, internationally known for his television series, Civilization. Some of you might remember that. That was quite a while back. He lived and he died without faith in Jesus. He admitted this in his autobiography. He said, while visiting a beautiful church, he had this overwhelming, beautiful religious experience. He said, "My whole being," Clark wrote, "was radiating by a kind of heavenly joy far more intense than anything I had ever experienced before." But then he continued to describe it. He said, "The gloom of grace created a problem." He said, "If I allowed myself to be influenced by this grace, I knew that I would have to change my life. And my family and friends might think I have lost my mind. And maybe this intense joy would prove to just be an illusion." So Mr. Clark concluded, "I was too deeply embedded in the world to change course." He really wasn't, but that's what he chose. Direction determines destination. And last of all, there is the converted heart. Some of the seeds fell on good ground. It takes full root, it grew deep before it grew up, and it produced faith in Christ and a service that is glorifying to God. In Reader's Digest, there was a contributor told of Aunt Ruby and Uncle Arnie, who had adopted a baby boy after 5 years of trying unsuccessfully to conceive. To their surprise, a short time after their adoption, Aunt Ruby discovered she was now pregnant, and she later gave birth to a boy. One day when the two boys were 8 and 9 years old, the teller of the story was visiting Aunt Ruby, and a woman in the neighborhood came over to visit. Observing the children at play, the visiting woman said, "Which boy is yours, Ruby?" She replied immediately, "Both of them are mine." No, I mean, which one is really yours and not adopted?" Aunt Ruby did not hesitate. In her finest hour, she looked straight at her guest and she replied, I've forgotten. When we are adopted as God's children, we quickly come to cherish our Heavenly Father's forgiveness. He chooses to forget our sins. He chooses to forget our wayward past. He chooses us to give to us full rights as sons and daughters. He treats us as if we had never sinned. Guys, isn't that good seed that we ought to be scattering about this relationship that we have with God? Let me wrap this up. I don't think I told this one to you all last week. If I did, forgive me. In 1981, a Minnesota radio station reported a story about a stolen car in California. Police were staging this intense research for the vehicle and the driver, even to the point of placing announcements on local radio stations to try to contact the thief through the airways. The reason they were doing this is because on the front seat of the stolen car sat a box of crackers that, unknown to the thief, had been laced with poison. The car owner had intended to use the crackers as rat bait. And now the police and the owner of the Volkswagen Bug, not a very discerning car thief, was he? The owner of a Volkswagen, sorry. Sorry, Fawn. They were more interested in apprehending the thief to save his life rather than to recover the car. So often today, there are people who run from God. They feel like that they have to escape His punishment. But what we are actually doing is we are eluding His rescue. Let us as God's children be about sowing this incredibly precious seed, praying that it will rescue somebody from their own destruction, from the pits of hell, and take them to the palaces of heaven. Sounds like a good plan, doesn't it? Let's start sowing some precious seed. Are you ready to be a farmer? You'll never be a harvester. You'll never carry in the sheaves if you never plant any seed. Let's pray. Our Father, thank you so very much for the challenge, the reminder of the precious gift we've been given in the person of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, let's understand this is serious. This is not just life and death. This is eternal matters. And you have given to us a precious gift. We tend to hold on to the gift thinking that if we hold on to it, it will stay special, when the reality is the more we give your gift away, the more special it becomes to us. Just as everyone in this room, except for Helen, was able to say, "Somebody pointed me to Christ," then Father, let us be the name on somebody else's lips someday, somewhere, sometime that will say, "John, Tim, Shelley, Fawn, Mary, Bill, Georgia pointed me in the right direction, and that has changed my destination." In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Go sow some seeds, folks. Have a great day.